Yeah, I'll walk in with the Bible. Don't worry. Okay, Anne, let's go. You have to move it after I say welcome. Happy Easter, everyone. The first hymn, I think you know it, is Christ the Lord is Risen Today. Now, it's hallelujah, isn't it, between each verse. We'll go to the first slide and we'll have a quick look. Yes, after each one, yes. I think Rob's probably fixed it all up for us. So let us sing, Christ the Lord is Risen Today. Hallelujah. Risen Christ in our lives, for the gift of your Holy Spirit that you pour into our hearts so we may know your love, for the joy and peace that we receive so we may bear fruit for your kingdom. We give thanks, Lord, that your Spirit fills us with hope for the future. Let the church proclaim he is risen. For blessed are you, Lord God our Father, by your power our Lord Jesus Christ has risen from the dead. And Lord Jesus, we rejoice and celebrate that you who was dead is alive, you who was buried is risen. Hallelujah to our Lord Jesus Christ, conqueror of death and hell. Hallelujah to you, Christ, the gateway to life everlasting. Because of you, death is conquered and we are free. For you, Christ, have won the victory. And Holy Spirit, we give you our thanks and praise. Come upon us today so we may understand the gospel and claim it as our good news. Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, we praise you for this glorious day. And Lord, you help us to see your majesty in all of life, in its sunsets and sunrises, in its light and darkness, in its tombs and gardens, and in the faces of our loved ones and the beauty of our homes. So, loving God, open our graces and give us life so that all that has been buried may be freed and forgiven. And set our hearts free as we come to you in this moment of silence with all our concerns and need for forgiveness. Hear then Christ's words of grace to us. Your sins are forgiven. Now we're going to start with the peace. Wish each other happy Easter. So the peace of the Lord be with you. Let's offer each other a greeting of peace.
Peace be with you, John.
Come, let us with our Lord arise.
Thank you. 20, verses 1 to 18. Early on the first day of the week, while it was still dark, Mary Magdalene came to the tomb and saw that the stone had been removed from the tomb. She ran and went to Simon Peter, the other disciple, the one whom Jesus loved, and said to them, "They have taken the Lord out of the tomb, and we do not know where they have laid him." Then Peter and the other disciple set out and went toward the tomb. The two were running together, but the other disciple outran Peter and reached the tomb first. He bent down to look in and saw that the linen wrappings lying there, but he did not go in. Then Simon Peter came following him and went into the tomb. He saw the linen wrappings lying there and the cloth that had been on Jesus' head, not lying with the linen wrappings, but rolled in a place by itself. Then the other disciple, who reached the tomb first, also went in, and he saw and he believed, for as yet they did not understand the scripture that he must rise from the dead. Then the disciples returned to their homes. But Mary stood weeping outside the tomb. As she wept, she bent over to look into the tomb and saw two angels in white sitting where the body of Jesus had been lying, one at the head and the other at the feet. They said to her, "Woman, why are you weeping?" She said to them, "They have taken away my Lord, and I do not know where they have laid him." When she had said this, she turned around and saw Jesus standing there, but she did not know it was Jesus. Jesus said to her, "Woman, why are you weeping? Whom are you looking for?" Supposing him to be the gardener, she said to him, "Sir, if you have carried him away, tell me where you have laid him, and I will take him away." Jesus said to her, "Mary." She turned and said to him in Hebrew, "Rabboni," which means teacher. Jesus said to her, "Do not touch me, because I have not yet ascended to the Father. But go to my brothers and say to them, I am ascending to my Father and your Father, to my God and your God." Mary Magdalene went and announced to the disciples, "I have seen the Lord," and she told them that he had said these things to her.
Do we have any children here today? Or big children? So, I'm fascinated by butterflies. So I've got, you know what this is. Now, why do you think butterflies have got something to do with Easter? Has anyone got any ideas? Because it'd be nice to make a connection. Yeah? Yes? What? Emerging from the chrysalis. Okay. New life? Sorry? The deaf? Transformation? Yep. There you go. So that's the connection. To die, to be reborn, yes. Okay, so I hope that I open this the right way. I don't want to get the caterpillar. I want to get the butterfly. Now the butterfly is coming out of a tomb-like place where it's been developing for a very long time into something beautiful. Just zip this little butterfly up. It does actually, kids can put their hands underneath and make them fly. My grandkids love this. I have to hide it from them. It's very soft. So, a butterfly. Do you think we ever go through this sort of thing? You know, like we're caterpillars for a little while, we're taking it all in, then we go into a quiet place, spend some time putting it all together and developing, and then emerge just like a butterfly, and we sort of, something in us dies so we can embrace something new. Do you think that happens to us? Could do, yeah. We could grow moments like that. Yeah. I do think that I've spent probably maybe 50 years of my life being a caterpillar until I slowed down and just did formation and put it all together, and then hopefully I'm probably a bit of a rough budgie or a rough looking butterfly, but I've emerged. I'm not perfect. This one's much better looking than me. But yes, we do have moments in life where we go through the tomb-like experience and emerge. You know, we're transformed by God. So that's, I think, do you think that's why butterflies? Yeah, and there's lots of other, we could go to lots of places with butterflies. Yes, and we've all got different ideas about butterflies. If you were a butterfly, what kind of butterfly would you like to be? These ones migrate. There's so many beautiful butterflies. Yes, there's some nice, that's from the butterfly house at the zoo, the golden one. The other one was in some garden somewhere. Yeah, it's nice. Yes, so think about what kind of butterfly you'd like to be. You'd like to migrate with all the tribe. It's a long flight. It's a very good flight though, isn't it? I'll leave that little butterfly up here. So we're going to sing, don't you like that image? That's so beautiful. I haven't seen that one before. We get Revised Common Lectionary, if you ever want to have a look at it, has all the readings and it has paintings. And every year we get a different image of Jesus. So that one's Jesus, you know, like it's quite nice. I like the eyes and the blue in the background. But yes, every year we get a new image of Jesus. We all have a different image of Jesus. So let's sing Yours Be the Glory.
Thank you. much happening, so I'll just quickly go over the main points of the story. So we have Mary going to the tomb in the early morning, and she sees the stone door rolled away and concludes immediately that someone's stolen Jesus' body. And she goes and she tells Peter and the disciple who Jesus loves, and they run to the tomb. And it's Peter who enters first. And we don't know what he thinks or feels. He sees the linen wrappings lying there and the cloth from Jesus' head rolled up in a place by itself. Then the disciple who Jesus loves enters the tomb and sees what Peter sees and believes. At this stage, they don't understand scripture about Jesus rising. So they go home. Perhaps they saw just an empty tomb as they were walking back and talking about it. Or like perhaps the disciple who Jesus loved, you know, sensed not absence but presence in the tomb. And of course Mary is standing outside the tomb. She hasn't gone inside. She looks inside and sees two angels, and they ask her why she's weeping. And she says because they have stolen Jesus' body. So she's focused on his dead body. And all of them, in fact, even the disciple who Jesus loved, are focused on the empty tomb at this stage. And then when Mary turns around, she doesn't recognize Jesus. Maybe he looked different, or maybe her grief was blinding her. And they're in a garden outside the tomb, and Jesus asks her the same question the angels asked. Woman, why are you weeping? And then she accuses him of stealing his own body. And this is when things change dramatically.
Jesus says, Mary. And she calls out Rabboni, which means teacher or great one. It's a term of endearment. Perhaps she embraced him because he asked her not to hold on to him because he hadn't yet ascended to the Father. That indicates that their relationship is different and he's different within himself. And time is short and his role now is to ascend to heaven. Perhaps when Mary embraced Jesus, she forgot all about her grief. Perhaps she was feeling awe or excitement, or all of these feelings, or joy, great joy, because he was alive, he was risen. She'd held him, she knew. She was standing before him as the first witness to the resurrection. And he commissioned her to take a message to the other disciples. It is a I am statement, which is interesting, because all of those statements are about Jesus' identity and divinity. So he says, I am ascending to my Father and to your Father and to my God and your God. And so Mary does what Jesus asks and returns to the disciples and says, I have seen the Lord, and delivers Jesus' message to him, to them all. So there's a lot to ponder about in today's gospel. But it's really interesting that there's three kinds of faith. There's a faith of the disciple Jesus loved, who didn't see Jesus in the empty tomb. All he saw was the linen wrappings, but he believed. He didn't fully understand, but he must have known in his heart Jesus had risen. He didn't need to see Jesus, nor did he need to understand scripture. And perhaps, like I said, he sensed a presence. Perhaps the Holy Spirit helped him know and believe. He's a bit like the people that we know in our lives or ourselves who have this unshakable faith, and no matter what we believe, we don't need to see Jesus, we believe, and we don't need to understand everything. We know that Jesus has risen and with us. Then there's the faith of Peter. He entered the tomb, and we don't know what he felt or thought. We do know later on that he did meet the risen Jesus several times and ate breakfast with him, and he was convinced over time that Jesus had risen. So perhaps there are many people in the world like Peter who need time to check out things and be convinced before they believe. That's part of the Christian journey. But then we have something unique at this time, at Jesus' time when he was with amongst all his disciples. We have the faith of Mary. Blind in her grief, she did not go into the tomb. She looked inside and saw angels, but continued to grieve. She saw Jesus and in her grief did not recognize him. And of course, she may be like many people who know grief. Grief because of wounds, loss, mistreatment, exclusion, or rejection, or loneliness, or addictions, or health issues. Perhaps some people who are suffering deeply and wounded deeply for a while spend time focused on their wounds, and that takes their energy. And they may not be open to seeing God's glory and beauty all around them. Such is the depth of their suffering and their pain. Perhaps Mary felt like this at that moment, after she'd seen Jesus die a horrible death. Perhaps she felt all was lost and lost hope. But then when she hears Jesus' voice, she forgets her grief. She recognizes his voice. And she becomes the first witness to the resurrection. And it transforms her from a frightened, grieving woman to a leader in the early church. It's the beginning of her resurrection faith. And Mary was well known in the Eastern Church. There's an icon up there of her holding an egg. And the egg, of course, is symbolizing new life from the tomb. Perhaps Mary went to Turkey or Greece. It seems she wasn't well known in the Western Church, who often mistook her for the other Marys, like Mary of Bethany, or the woman who had demons cast out of her. The West often portrayed Mary as a sinner, but the East portrayed her as a saint and a leader of the early church. And she was known as a wealthy businesswoman. Now, I was at the CTM library. I don't know whether you've been there. They've got some interesting things there, like the Gospel of Thomas, which wasn't accepted, of course, in our Bible. But there is a Gospel of Mary of Magdalene, and they've whited out most of what she's written. There may be a copy in the East, some Orthodox church, with all the words left. I hope I get to see that one time in my life and read it. I'm curious now after seeing a gospel where everything is whited out, and I wonder why. I'll leave that to another time to explore. But yes, I would like to see something like that. So today's gospel, and we'll go to the image of Jesus. Have we got that? We'll go a little bit earlier. Oh yes, there it is. So perhaps the gospel asks us where we are with our faith and belief with Jesus. Are we like Peter or the disciple who Jesus loved? Or are we like Mary? Or maybe we're a little bit like all of them. Today's gospel perhaps leaves us wondering about why Peter and the disciple who Jesus loved went into the tomb and Mary didn't. And why didn't Peter and the disciple see Jesus? Why Mary? It's something quite unique, as I said. And perhaps the resurrection story doesn't begin in the tomb. The tomb has a role to remind us it's a place of death that all of us must leave behind. Perhaps the cloths symbolize old ways that need to be let go of so we can see and know new life, like the disciple whom Jesus loved and Peter discovered in their faith journey. They came to know new life is possible and believed Jesus had risen. They left behind the memory of the discarded linen cloths so they could come to know the risen Jesus. But the resurrection story doesn't begin in the tomb. Perhaps it begins in the garden near the tomb. There's an interesting connection here where humanity is welcomed back from exile from the Garden of Eden. And in Mary, humanity has returned to paradise. Jesus has defeated the darkness and the evil that began in the Garden of Eden with Eve. And this is a new beginning for all. And Mary had to be the first witness to heal the rift created by Eve. And now all humanity is restored to the garden of life because of Jesus. Now that's something to ponder on, because why else have a garden? And why else have Mary? Perhaps that is the connection. There are many gardens that we may have been excluded from in life because of circumstances beyond our control. But there are also gardens of deep gladness and peace and closeness. Gardens where Jesus calls our name in our heart and we hear him and leave behind what excluded us from wholeness and happiness so that Jesus can restore us and heal us. This is something Jesus is constantly doing for all of us and reminding us not to hold on to old ways that keep us far from life, old ways that prevent us and keep us out of the garden of paradise, old ways that stop us from following the risen Christ. Jesus is risen, and perhaps today's gospel is inviting us to rise too. The Lord be with you. Now we've got to have some lovely music from Shoshini and Mermelini. It's I Know That My Redeemer Liveth from Handel's Messiah. We say the prayer together. Lord and giver of every good thing, we bring to you our lives and gifts for your kingdom, all for transformation, for your grace and love, made known in Jesus Christ our Saviour. Amen. The prayers of the people have been adapted from David Adam's prayers from his book called Radiance of His Glory. Lord Jesus, we remember your words to the disciples, peace be with you. We pray for peace in our world so that we can rise above all that causes conflict and war. Christ Jesus, risen in glory, we ask you to scatter darkness from our world. Risen Lord, as you appeared to Mary in the garden, be known amongst us, in our worship and church, in our homes and workplaces, in our communities and in our journeying. Risen Lord, let us be your presence in peace with you and one another. Christ Jesus, risen in glory, scatter darkness from our world. And Lord, we bring before you all who are in darkness and fear and suffering, all who are weighed down with heavy burdens, all who have given up hope, for all who are approaching death, for those caring for the terminally ill, for those in a hospice, for those undergoing treatment for cancer or serious illness, for those recovering from operations or medical treatment or serious illness, for all health professionals and carers, for those struggling with dementia and mental health issues, for those in the community without food and heating, and for the homeless facing a cold winter. Christ Jesus, risen in glory, scatter darkness from our world. And we rejoice in the glory of the risen Lord. We pray for our loved ones who have departed before us. We pray for one another. We pray for all those within our community celebrating Easter today. May everyone rejoice in your presence, Lord. Christ Jesus, risen in glory, we give thanks that you scatter darkness from our world. And we join together in saying the Lord's Prayer.
Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. Save us from the time of trial and deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen.
Anyone would like to pray for someone or something?
For Arthur Watson in his slow recovery from surgery.
Prayers for Arthur Watson and his slow recovery from surgery.
Over the past 12 months, over 1,000 motorcycle riders have been admitted to hospital in Victoria because of accidents. I'd like to pray for the motorcycle community for greater safety awareness.
Prayers for all the motorcycle riders, and there's many thousands of them injured and who have died. Having worked when my kids were little, as a ward clerk in a hospital, prayers for everyone that's injured by chainsaws. It's not nice. And if there's someone in hospital at the moment, that's a prayer for them.
Prayers for Lorna, who's in first line care.
Prayers for Lorna,
respite care. And prayers for Val, who's not with us today. Is Val here? No. So prayers for Val. I'm sure she'll be thinking of us and praying for us.
For my friend Joyce, 90 years old, looking after her 60-year-old daughter who has severe cancer.
Oh, that's tough. So your friend Joyce. For all the places in the world where people are worshipping God at this Easter, but they're surrounded by war and trauma and conflict. And we think of Jerusalem.
Can we pray for all of the people who are working over this weekend?
Prayers for all those who have to work today and can't go to an Easter Sunday service. I've seen that grief in different people who have, when they brought Sunday trading in.
Prayers for all those who are homeless
this night. Prayers for those who are homeless, days cold and wet. Prayers for all those who provide shelter and food and comfort today, you know, rather than being with their families, they're there helping those who are homeless. Prayers for all those who are travelling to see their families today. This is a very special day when families get together. May they have a happy day and a safe day.
A prayer for yourself in your ministry and also for healing for Peter Kennedy.
Prayer for Peter and your continued recovery, Peter. And prayers for me. Thank you. Special celebrations today.
Prayer for the Pope.
Prayer for the Pope. There you go.
Yeah.
He has got a tough job, hasn't he? So many Catholics in the world. My husband's at church at the moment. He's Catholic.
A prayer for me, I guess, a thank you prayer, because I will reach 72 years of age tomorrow.
Oh, wow. Prayers for Christine, 72 tomorrow, giving thanks. Sashini and her mum, Nirmalini, are going to play this joyful Eastertide for us.
Thank you.
Thank you to everyone. We've got a huge team who contributed to our worship today. Thank you for your ministry. Now we've got a blessing. I invite you to say it together. May the Lord be our strength and might. May we see Jesus in one another and know him in our hearts. May we be touched by the Lord's presence and surprised by joy. May we be blessed by belief in the resurrection of our Lord. And may the Holy Spirit give us courage and faith for the journey. Amen. Our final hymn is, Hallelujah, Hallelujah, give thanks to the risen Lord.